Ok. Where do we get started? So we talk about, so we start with first order necessary condition for optimality. This was the first thing we studied. So X star locally minimum implies gradient of f at x star is equal to 0. Then we studied second order necessary condition. So x star locally minimum implies the second derivative at x star is greater than or equal to 0. And then we had sufficient condition, x bar satisfies gradient f at x bar equal to 0. Second derivative at x bar is strictly positive definite, then x bar is locally minimum. Okay? This is what we have we proved in the class, and it involved manipulating some matrices. Okay? Nothing beyond that. Fairly simple to prove results. Okay? And hopefully by now you are comfortable with reading, understanding, and perhaps even doing proofs because of the assignments and homeworks that you have done in this class. Okay? And also the papers you might have read. Okay? So that was one of the goals of this course, okay, to make you comfortable with proofs and to be able to prove things on your own. Okay? Not big results, but at least easier ones. Okay, so these are the three conditions. We know that if this is the entire space, let's say Rn, then this will be the set of points that satisfy the necessary condition. This would be the set of points that satisfy, that are actually optimal points. So let me denote it by curly O. And these are the points that would satisfy sufficient condition. Okay? So the points that satisfy sufficient condition would definitely satisfy necessary conditions as well, because they are locally optimal. Okay? So there is a strict inclusion that you see among these sets. So sufficient condition is a subset of the set of optimal points, which is a subset of the points that satisfy necessary condition. Okay? You could have problems in which there is no optimal solution, but there is a point that satisfies necessary condition. And the example is x cube, for instance. Okay, it doesn't have any optimal point. If you want to minimize x cube, it doesn't have any optimal point. But x equal to 0 satisfies both first order necessary condition and second order necessary condition. Okay. So the goal in gradient descent, so gradient descent algorithm was discussed heavily to solve these problems to minimize fx subject to x and Rn. So what was the goal in gradient descent? So it is to iteratively find x star that satisfies first order necessary condition. As you can see how problematic this goal is, but this is the best we can do. And you did an example in one of the assignments where you ran gradient descent on x cube and you found a point x equal to 0 through the gradient descent method. That's because x equal to 0 satisfies the first order necessary condition. Okay? In fact, you're not even looking for points that satisfy second order necessary condition. Okay? All you're looking for is points that satisfy first order necessary condition. And that's really the big challenge or big issue with gradient descent. That's really the big issue with maximum principle as well. Okay? All you're looking for a point that satisfies first order necessary condition. So there's no guarantee of optimality, unless you assume that the function is convex, or you prove that the point x star that you find also satisfies the sufficiency condition, which means that the second derivative is strictly positive definite. Okay. Now, I haven't seen many papers. Papers that don't look into convexity. Don't look into convex problems. So there are many papers that look at non-convex problems, run gradient descent, find x star, okay, that satisfies first order necessary condition, and then claim that it is the optimal point or it is a local minimum. Okay, that's wrong. That should not be done. If it only satisfies first order necessary condition, you have to say it satisfies first order necessary condition, and we cannot guarantee whether it's a local minimum or not. Okay. So that was the gradient descent method. And then what was the gradient descent method? Well, xk plus 1 equals xk minus alpha k dk, gradient of fxk. And in most cases, we want dk to be an approximation of the second derivative inverse, second derivative of the function inverse. Okay, and there were many algorithms where we did that. So one was least square algorithm. Then the second one was BFGS and DFP, and of course the Newton's method, right? In steepest descent, actually DK was taken to be equal to identity. Okay, so that's not an approximation. So in that case, in the steepest descent, DK is not an approximation of the inverse of the second derivative of the function. Okay, so those were the algorithms that we studied, besides a couple of few other algorithms that are not, well, they are important, but I won't be reviewing them. Okay, so that was almost middle of September. Okay, we reviewed 1 month of material in 10 minutes. So that tells you how easy this course is, okay? Okay, so okay, any question on this? This was unconstrained optimization, yes. So remember, in the Newton's method, dk is exactly the second derivative inverse. Okay, that's in Newton's method. But since computing the second derivative and taking the inverse might be a difficult thing computationally, so you came up with the approximation of BFGS and DFP to approximately compute the second derivative. In least square, on the other hand, the second derivative had a term that was strictly positive definite and another term that was almost equal to zero. So you kind of ignore that term, in which case DK was just an approximation to the second derivative inverse. Okay, now the other important thing here is, how do you choose the step size alpha k? So some of the things that we studied was you can have a constant step size, you can have some reducing step size, you can use Armijo's rule to compute the step size. But what's the physical significance? What exactly are you doing by adapting this alpha k with every xk? Well, you are changing the contraction coefficient of the map T. Okay, the map T that we have discussed. So what is T of X? That's identity minus alpha and D gradient of F evaluated at X. Okay, so this is the map T, and you are changing by picking an appropriate value of alpha and appropriate D. You are essentially changing the contraction coefficient of this map T. So that's part of your Banach contraction mapping theorem. You know, this idea doesn't work in all circumstances uniformly, but it gives you an idea of what exactly you are doing for a very large class of functions. What exactly are you doing by picking an appropriate value of alpha? You're essentially changing the contraction coefficient so that the function converges to the point x star that satisfies FOMC quickly. Okay, so by changing the value of alpha, you really change the speed with which it converges to the locally optimal point. Okay. Of course, I couldn't talk about this alpha thing in the beginning of the class because I hadn't introduced Banach contraction mapping theorem. But now that we know, you essentially can understand what you are doing here. Okay, so it's not a black box anymore. Gradient descent is not a black box anymore. Okay, you know what we are doing. Okay. Then we moved on to constraint optimization problem. So we want to minimize a function over a convex set. Okay. So I want to minimize f of x, x is in a convex set capital X. Okay, the necessary condition was gradient of fx star, so x star optimal implies gradient of f at x star transpose x minus x star is greater than or equal to 0 for every x in capital X. Okay. Again, we want to find this point x star that satisfies the necessary condition in this case. And we somehow want to use gradient descent. Okay. We want to use this method for this particular problem, constraint optimization problem. So the major problem that one would encounter is as follows. You have this set, convex set X. You started with some point X naught. Okay, you ran gradient descent. And then you get to a point that is outside the set. Okay, so you don't want that to happen. You want to remain within the set while you are running the gradient descent algorithm. So what do we do? Right? Projection. Right? So one idea is, well, we can project this point back onto the set. Okay, as soon as we go out of the set, we project this point back onto the set. So that's one idea. Okay, so the problem is gradient descent runs out of the set. Okay, so the solution, so we adopted two solutions. The first solution was gradient projection. Okay, so we see a point that's so we run the gradient descent, we figure out that there is a point that's outside the set, we project it back onto the set. So that's the gradient projection method. And the second one was to it's called conditional gradient or Frank-Wohl method. And the idea is find the best descent direction within the set. Okay. So one idea, the first idea is to project the solution back. The second idea is, well, I'm standing here, I'm going to look at all possible directions and figure out which is the best direction to descend into. Okay, and I'll choose the step size again using Armijo's rule or constant step size or whatever, right? One of many techniques of picking a step size. Okay? Then we said, you know what? Many a times your X has more structure than just a arbitrary convex set. Okay, so your X could be a simplex, not a simplex, but a, so your X could be a set X in Rn such that A X is equal to B, or your X could be X in Rn, AX equal to B and X greater than equal to 0. Or you could have X in Rn, AX is less than equal to B. Okay? So this is a linear manifold in Rn. So there's a lot of structure in this set. So somehow we want to devise an algorithm that exploits the fact that our set, the constraint set, has such a structure. Okay? So what did we do? Well, we talked about a fine scaling method for this class of set, and then we talked about simplex method. Well, simplex is used in the context of linear program. We called it a manifold suboptimization. Okay. So if your set is sphere or ellipsoid or some sort of I don't know what else. What are the most general? Yeah, you could also have a set that is like box constraints. So for sphere, ellipsoid, box constraints, you can use one of these two techniques. Okay, because there is little structure. Well, box constraint can be written also in this form. Okay, so for sphere and ellipsoid, for instance, you can use one of these two techniques. Because it's much easier to project the point back onto the set in those settings. But if your problem has a little bit more structure, especially you have linear constraints, then you can use affine scaling and you can use simplex method. Now, in affine scaling, the philosophy is I'm going to go within the set, in the interior of the set, and I'm going to approach the optimal point. So in affine scaling, this is your constraint set. You started with a point in the interior, x naught, and then let's say this is the optimal point. Then you would go in this direction, you would go in this direction, you would go in this direction. Okay? And then you will try to approach this optimal point eventually. So that was affine scaling. In the simplex, the idea is you start from a point on the inside, then you move towards the outside point, so you reach one of these edges, and then once you reach the edge, you move along the edge. Okay? And then you reach the optimal point. Okay? If needed, so for instance in manifold suboptimization, if it is needed, then you can go inside and then get to the optimal point. Okay? So the underlying philosophy in these two techniques is completely different. One goes through the set, the other one goes from the outside. Well, not outside, but on the boundary of the set. Okay? So we started with unconstrained optimization. Then we wanted to adapt unconstrained optimization to constrained optimization. So two obvious idea was to use projection or find the best descent direction within the constraint set. Then we said, you know what? Sometimes, or most of the times, the sets have more structure than this, so we should exploit that information about the set. And so then people came up with these two techniques, one that goes through the set, the other one that goes from the boundary of the set. Okay, so that's early October. Any questions so far on the constrained optimization? Yes. Yes, they are the same. So if you're doing linear, if you read a linear programming book, they will call it a simplex method. If you're reading a nonlinear programming book or paper, they'll call it manifold suboptimization. But it's the same method. You always go from the boundary of the set. Okay, you're traversing the boundary of the set to get to the optimal point. No. No, like I said, it's written in the book, and I also mentioned it in the class. This method seems to have the best theoretical performance. This method seems to have the best, well, in most cases, best practical performance. Okay, so, and there is a, in the next topic will be the barrier method, and I'll talk more about its relationship with the simplex method, with the affine scaling method. Yes?
The two solutions are for a more general structure.
That's right. So, sphere, ellipsoid. In box, projection is very easy. So, you could potentially use, you can either use simplex method for box, you could use affine scaling for box, or you could also use gradient projection for box. Okay, so projection is not a computationally intensive activity if you have a box constraint. Any other question? No? Okay. So we did optimization over convex set. Now, somebody came in and said, you know what? Not all the time you will have a convex set over which you are optimizing. Okay, you could have a set of you could have a set of equality or inequality constraints that characterize the feasible point. And so now you have a completely different problem, a problem that is completely non-convex. Non-convex optimization, non-convex objective function with non-convex constraints. So how do you solve them? So you want to minimize fx such that h of x equal to 0, g of x is less than equal to 0. Okay? And they could be arbitrary nonlinear functions. And this feasible point need not form a convex set. The set of feasible points need not be convex. So what do? The first thing that we have done for the unconstrained and for the constrained optimization was to come up with necessary conditions for optimality. So it turns out that even for this problem, we need to come up with necessary conditions for optimality. So what do we do? Well, Karush Kuntakar came to our rescue, and they came up with KKD conditions. Okay, but before we introduce KKD condition, well, it has already been introduced, but before we recall, we need to recall one definition, several definitions. If the set of active constraints is J in 1 to R, such that GJ of X is equal to 0. Then we define x is regular, so that's definition 1. Then definition 2, x is regular if, anyone remembers what the definition of regularity was? Sorry? Hx or gradient of Hx? Gradient of Hx, okay? So x is regular if and only if gradient of h1 of x, gradient of hm of x, gradient of gj of x for all j in ax are independent. Okay. So you have all the gradient of all equality constraint and the gradient of inequality constraints that are active at that particular point. So that tells you whether x is regular or not. And then there is definition 3, which was your V of x, which is the set of D in Rn that satisfy the first order variations in the constraint set. So that's gradient of Hi x transpose d equals to 0 and gradient of gj x transpose d equal to 0 for all j in ax. Okay, so these are the three definitions we need to remember, we need to keep that in mind. Okay. So what did KKD, what did Karushkon and Tucker, very famous mathematicians, what did they say? Well, they said that if, so the theorem is x star is optimal and regular, then there exist lambda star in Rm, mu star in Rr, such that gradient of x of the Lagrangian L evaluated at x star, lambda star, mu star is equal to 0. We had mu j star dj x star is equal to 0 for all j, and then we had mu j star equal to 0 for all j that is not active. And the fourth was this, so these are the first order necessary condition F, O, N, C, and then we have second order necessary condition D transpose second derivative of L D is greater than equal to 0 for all D in V X star. Okay. So it would be good to look at a picture. So let's say this is my surface 1, this is my surface 2, and now this is my optimal point, this is my point x star. So gradient of H1 would be normal to this. So this is my H1 of X. So this is gradient X star. Great. This is my H2 of X. So the gradient of H2 is going to look something like this. That will be normal to the second surface. And you would have, let me write this as X star. And you will have gradient of Fx somewhere here. Okay. Oh, I didn't write mu j is greater than equal to 0. So mu j star is greater than equal to 0. Okay. So what KKD condition says, especially the first condition, is that the gradient of Fx star is going to be in the plane spanned by gradient of H2 and gradient of H1 evaluated at X star passing through the point X star. Okay, so these are the two gradients in the space, so they span a plane, and the gradient of F has to be within that plane. Okay, it can't be going out of the plane in any direction. So that's the first order necessary condition of optimality. Of course, some of these things appear in the proof, so I don't want to go into that. But that's the meaning, that's the geometric significance of this particular result. And what is the second order necessary condition? Well, I look at the first order variation, so this is my D1, and this would be my D2. Okay, from this point, so I have to move in the direction of the constraint set. So I'm going to move in this direction, and I'm going to move in that direction. And what it says is, well, the second derivative of L should be positive semi-definite along these two directions. Okay, it doesn't matter if it is negative definite along other directions, but along this direction, which is the first order feasible variation, the second derivative has to be positive semi-definite. Okay. So if you plot the value of function along that line, you will see that the function has some sort of minimum. So this is a curved line, but let me straighten it out. It's going to look something like this. And then the function is going to look like this. This will be my X star, the optimal point. And what this is saying is along this direction, if you look at the function locally, it's going to look like a convex function. Not very surprising if you can visualize it geometrically. Okay. So that was KKD condition. And once we understood that, well, we need to look for a set of X star, lambda star, and mu star that satisfy these three conditions. So that's what our goal should be. So then we defined several methods that looks for such a point in this high dimensional space. Okay, any questions so far? No? Okay, so even in unconstrained optimization, we look for a point that satisfies first order necessary condition. In the convex optimization over a convex set, we again look for a point that satisfies first order necessary condition. Now for a constrained optimization, we again look for a point and corresponding Lagrange multiplier that satisfy first order necessary condition. So that tells you that this entire field of optimization is completely based, I mean the algorithms are completely based on first order necessary condition. Okay? Nobody goes into second order necessary conditions at all while designing these algorithms. Of course, many people try to convexify the problem. So if you go and read research papers, you are posed a non-convex problem, and then people spend a lot of time just trying to convexify the problem, because then the optimality guarantee is by default, okay? And there are many ways to do it. Let me see if I have some time to talk about it. So we studied barrier method, where the goal was to create barrier function and then find xk that is in the argmin of fx plus epsilon k dx. X in Rn. Okay. So you have inequality constraint. You created a barrier function that goes to infinity as you approach the boundary. And then you try to minimize this composite function. Epsilon k goes to 0 as k goes to infinity. Okay, and in this, we had the central path method for linear programming where xk was argmin x in Rn of C transpose x minus epsilon k summation log of xi, I equals 1 to n. X in Rn, and I think it also had Ax equal to b. Okay? And this is the best method currently known. Well, not the best. I mean, people have improved upon it. But the best theoretically, so this is provably n raised to 3.5. The complexity is n raised to 3.5 plus. Okay, there are some other terms as well. So this has the best theoretical performance. And what's the idea? I have this set over which I am trying to solve this optimization problem. And there is a central path that goes to the optimal point. This is my x star. So how am I going to solve this problem? Well, I'll start with some initial x naught. I will run Newton's method so that I get close to the central path. Then I change the value of epsilon, run a single Newton step, I still remain close to the central path. Then I change the value of epsilon and run one Newton method, I still stay close to the central path. And I continue this process and I converge to the optimal point eventually. Okay, so that was the central path algorithm. Yes, so once, so first when you get, so the first thing is to get closer to the central path. Well, Newton's method.
So all these things are used in Newton's method?
Well, yes, I think there is a way to incorporate this this constraint as well.
So it means Newton's method is the local, they have a very good convergence.
Yes. Remember, Newton's method has very good convergence rate in general. Right? So the idea here is to use Newton's method to get closer to the central path. Okay. And then once you get close to the central path, which is some initial maybe 5, 10, 15 steps, after that, all you have to do is take one Newton step. Okay, so xk plus 1 equals xk minus whatever, second derivative inverse gradient. And then you change the value of epsilon k. Okay, so epsilon k plus 1 would be epsilon k over 5 or epsilon k over 10. And then you run Newton's method again and again and again. Okay? And you, what you do is you trace the central path very closely and eventually you converge to the optimal point.
So you need to choose the epsilon?
Yes, you do have to choose the epsilon.
Okay, so how about the convergence order? What are
the steps? So n is, I think, the number of variables. Remember, x is an Rn, right? So it's the number of variables, but somehow you also have to accommodate for the fact how many constraints. Well, you can have at most n constraints, right? So I think n is, n is constant for this particular problem.
Is related to the dimension?
It is related to the dimension. I mean, all algorithms are related to the dimension in which you are performing the optimization.
So the mass of promise we can get a epsilon solution. The gradient is smaller than epsilon.
Well, you're not really looking for the gradient smaller than epsilon in this case.
Oh, you mean the function value close to the minimal?
Yeah. All you want is a point that is close to x star. Remember, it's a linear program, so the gradient will never be equal to zero, right? So this is how you solve it. You look for a point x star that is a candidate optimal, well, not a candidate, but the optimal solution. In this particular case, you have linear problem over linear set of constraints. There always exists, well, not always, but under sufficiently general condition, there exists an optimal solution. And you want to look for that optimal solution. So this is very similar to the affine scaling method, where you were essentially trying to, instead of going around the set at the boundary of the set, you want to go through the set to the optimal point. Okay? So that's the connection with the affine scaling method. In fact, affine scaling method was a motivation to study this barrier method for linear programming problem. Okay. Then we said, okay, fine, we are able to solve problems with inequality constraint. What about equality constraint? Well, we came up with penalty methods for equality constraint problems where we put a penalty for violating the constraint. Okay, now I want to minimize f of x such that hx equal to 0. Then I have the augmented Lagrangian. I want xk to be argmin of lck xk lambda k, and then xn rn. And I take ck going to infinity. And then, moreover, you can also update your Lagrange multiplier. Lambda k plus 1 equals lambda k plus ck hxk. And this method, where you are updating your lambda k according to this fashion, is known as method of multipliers. Okay. What was the purpose of picking a CK here? Anyone remembers? You have done an example with various values of CK, right? You ran simulations with various values of CK. What was the purpose of CK? Anyone remembers? Sorry? You solved a convex problem with equality constraint, right? So the purpose of CK was, again, to move the contraction coefficient of the composite map xk lambda k. Okay? This is also something that you proved within that problem. You figured out the eigenvalues of a matrix and how close or away from one it, I mean, how close it is to one. And if it is far away from one within the unit ball, then the algorithm converges pretty quickly. If it is far out and very close to this unit circle, then it takes a lot of iterations to converge, right? We saw that behavior in the assignment. So everything goes back to Banach contraction mapping theorem in some way or the other. It's not going to leave your leave you now, okay, from now on. So you will see this phenomena appearing again and again, this idea of using contraction maps to prove that the algorithm is going to converge. The other algorithm was a penalty method, so xk was in the argmin of fx plus ck max of absolute value of h1x and absolute value of hmx. Okay, this was the penalty method, and we talked about sequential dynamic programming. Penalty method. No, sequential quadratic programming to solve problems of this type. Okay, so these are some of the ways to solve. Oh, this is penalty method, and then the other one was Lagrangian method. Where the goal was to solve gradient of x comma lambda of Lx comma lambda equal to 0. So this is just like finding zeros of a set of polynomials, okay, or a set of nonlinear functions. So that's we study Newton's method to solve this problem in the class. Yes.
These are
FONC of KKT. Yes. FONC, it's a gradient of L of X star lambda star mu star is equal to 0.
What is the difference between barrier and central path?
There's no difference. Central path method is for linear programming, barrier method is more general for arbitrary problem. Okay, you can have many different types of barrier, not necessarily a logarithmic barrier. But for the linear programming case, logarithmic barrier gives you the best convergence rate. Yes? Any other question? Okay, so barrier method is used for inequality constraint problems. And then for equality constraint problem, you have method one, method two, method of multipliers. You can also adapt it to inequality constraint problems. And then you have penalty method, which can also be adopted to problems with equality and inequality constraints. And then you have Lagrangian method, which is essentially finding zeros of a bunch of nonlinear functions. Okay, and we used Newton's method to find the zeros. All of these algorithms are essentially trying to find the points that satisfy first order necessary conditions for optimality. Okay. So this is end of October. Okay. And then we said, you know what? So far, we have talked about differentiation and some matrix manipulations and so on. All of which fails for integer programming problem, for instance, okay? So there has to be a way, a structured way, a mathematically more sophisticated way of trying to solve integer programming problems, or problems that are very difficult, okay? So how do we solve them? How do we give guarantees of optimality? If we cannot solve a problem exactly, how can I tell people that, you know, the solution that I have found is better than what anyone else can find, okay? So the key idea there was to look at this particular problem in a geometric sense, okay? Not necessarily in the calculus sense, which is what we have been doing so far, okay? You see all differentiation and Newton's method and matrix inverse and so on until now. So we define the idea of duality, okay? So dual problem. So the idea of duality was, I am going to plot f of x and g of x for x in set x. So this is my g of x. Capital X. Okay, so I want to minimize f of x such that g of x is less than equal to 0, x in capital X. Okay. So we define the notion of geometric multiplier. Okay, so define multiplier mu, which is greater than equal to 0, and f star is equal to inf of L x mu star, x in capital X mu star greater than equal to 0. Okay, assuming that f star is a finite variable. And then when we looked at this problem geometrically, we realized that actually so for an arbitrary, so what is so L of x comma mu would look like a hyperplane, a generic hyperplane in this space. Okay, but we define another function. Okay, so that's the definition of geometric multiplier. It may or may not exist in the problems that you might be looking at. But then we defined a dual problem q mu, which is inf of x in x, L of x comma mu. Okay, this is my dual problem. Okay. Oh, I have already exceeded the time by 2 minutes. Okay, anyways, let me very quickly mention that this was the dual problem. This is your, so when you plot a line with normal mu star comma 1, it essentially intersects the y-axis at q mu star, and this would be your, or rather, not this, but this would be your f star, and this is the duality gap. And so we had the weak duality theorem, which said that q star is less than equal to f star, and then we gave conditions under which the duality gap is exactly equal to 0 in the context of linear problem with, or rather, convex problem with linear constraints. Okay, so the weak duality theorem is extremely important if you want to give guarantees of how good your solution is. So you come up with some heuristic to find an x star, you figured out what the function evaluated at x heuristic is, and then you solve this dual problem to find q star, and as long as the difference is very small, you know that you are close to the optimal, right? So that's the idea behind many difficult optimization problem. Just show that you are very close to the optimal dual solution, and then you are fine. Okay, everybody will treat you as a god. Okay, because you solved a difficult problem. Okay, so that's all we had on. We studied on static optimization, and then it was somewhat like first week of November, and then we started talking about dynamic optimization and optimization with some sort of stochasticity. So let's talk about it in the next class. We'll review the entire theory of dynamic optimization and stochastic programming in the next class. Thank you.